friendly on Facebook. I know, I mean, I'm certainly a member of quite a lot of volunteer groups. We may deem the service users under some definition. I have a friend this course of my work in the group. Am I not this far from doing so? Or should I just, do I simply have regard for this person?
Thank you, yeah. The background paragraph was included elsewhere in the report and the RC. Clearly made references to the obligations of staff as employees of the council and the potential implications for that if there's any issues with the policy. We clearly recognise that isn't the same with regards to the users, so we don't have that same fallback position if there are any concerns. So simply the reference is that some of the good practice within the policy and some of the duties of the community guidance around that, we would refer you to and the other groups mentioned. Hopefully accept that the policy doesn't apply in its entirety to volunteers and volunteers. We do have separate guidance for volunteers, working on our etc. In terms of what they can access sites. Similarly, staff who work in frontline services such as social care or in schools have got some very clear guidance and policies around use of social media, befriending service users, etc. etc. So it's kind of covered elsewhere. This is really intended as a general policy for council staff.
Just as a
Chris?
Sorry, thanks, Chair. Just make a question on the issue. Even if it's a volunteer staff or whatever, not directly employed by the council, surely legally the council is still responsible for what is done. Goes along the wires if you're on the network, so they should, policy should actually still apply to whoever wants to use the council's website or network system.
Yeah. I think just the point maybe from an HR policy point of view is the disciplinary sanction or the potential implications of misuse of policy wouldn't apply in the same way as the volunteer. We do have separate guidelines around misuse, but if there's an issue or complaint about volunteer use, or indeed as there may be a member of public in the library, etc., there are separate processes to go through in terms of dealing with that. And this was really about opening up social media channels to staff and putting some framework around the use of that.
I've just been reminded as well that we do have an article of conduct which is look at ourselves on social media as well. We're all finished. Are we our committee happy to recommend the approval of our social media policy to council?
Thank you.
So agenda item number 5 is security of access to council issued devices and Tommy or don't you present the report, thanks.
I'm certainly talking ahead, but I'd like to have to evaluate my team when he gets active with me.
There's a report request I think the last 2.5 years we came on some comments about security devices and security around access and the controls there on. This report sets out some background to that, mainly around the public service network. So, certain buildings we have to subscribe to, it sets out there how we're going to apply the public service network to be able to access paper. We have to have accreditation every year to view. If we have that access, it does compare the council's significant cost with the rest of the information regarding academic, for example. This report just sets out a background of that, the controls that are in place, and how the typical cost falls for them to the authorities to access the public service network. It's essentially here for information. If you don't just have any questions, you can probably ask me, but definitely George is more the expert on this side than me.
Any questions or comments? Okay, so we're happy to vote that report. Thank you.
That's easier than the last time.
Item number 6. Okay, everyone, item number 6 is net performance management report on the 2 agreements.
This is a regular update from the outcomes that we've got. The board's report to respond to the position as of the 30th of September. Again, the areas are highlighted in the appendix there. See the best we agree. It's going to the red areas. There's a lot of commonalities between the ones that come here on a regular basis. It's mainly around the performance appendix and service issues around attending to the orders. And again, we've got the housing vertical and travel tax issues. So I'll go through in detail. I'm taking questions from colleagues here, HR and transaction services. What do you require?
Thank you.
no disrespect to Tom who presented it on his behalf. But these, a lot of these have been here the whole year. They either were the wrong targets to begin with or we're just not making any progress, particularly concerns over the suppliers being paid within 30 days. I understand there's always or various documentation goes missing with excuse. It's such an important issue for small businesses to be paid on time, cash flow, and growth businesses. So I think we do really need to have a look at this. We're already busy this year with various task finishes, but I think it does need to be looked at in more detail. I can see some of the things that have come up, but a lot of the reasons given that will improve performance. The no pay, no purchase order, no pay, that seems to be the reason why things were improved for the last three occasions. So it doesn't seem to be having any improvements. And the same for the rest, I think a lot of them, like going into detail on any, because they do just keep coming up and it's the same answers. But it's the same answers coming back as well.
Yeah, I think your concerns have been shared. I know that I'd like to, with committee's approval, refer especially staff appraisal, which has been a persistent model form. We refer that to Adrian Jones, who I believe is a portfolio elder. And we could put a request in for the directors who make the attempt. Next committee.
Yeah.
So we've got some hands up. We've got Leah, David, Christina, and Phil.
Sorry, I'm not coming back. Suppliers. Number five on that is the introduction of electronic invoicing. I would have thought that would speed things up. So I'm kind of deliberate before. I would have thought electronic invoicing isn't that new, or is it?
No, we can have electronic invoicing for some invoices. It may be to listen to suppliers because we are looking at how we can expand that to other suppliers as well.
David?
Thank you, Chair. Point reference 25 at the top. This is probably a slightly obscure question in the sense that I do always tend to think how on earth anything that could be identification of fraud could possibly show as greed, but I understand the premise. The premise is identification of fraud, so we're being more successful in that, is that correct? So basically what we're saying is we've lost a lot of money, but at least we know where it's going. would that be my assumption?
That's to be fair, it's one of the indicators I think sales of government comes up in terms of benefit claims as well. It's highlighted the field and where the fraud is going from, what it could use of fraud or error, and then the classification of error, in terms of how the subsidy claims, which is like 30 classifications of fraud and error on that claim for, and each one attracts a different level of subsidy. So it goes through each different particular case, what the level is, what could be, or it's solved. We're going to use it, I say, let's look at the flow of the error. In terms of some of the errors, we can use the error. And then identify what it is, and we'll do some of the process.
We have Christina and Phil and Chris. Whilst
I appreciate we're going to send the performance appraisals to Adrian Jones, I do feel like we need to ask a few questions as well, because if you read that blurb that we've got this time, the PI has a target completion date of September around December. As such, the year-end forecast figure is the same as the September, which looks like number two figure. The target was met of 80% was met for managers, but not for all staff, right? 51% turnout, a significant improvement on the position the same time last year, 29%. I mean, this is ludicrous. What they say it was 3% the year before, it went to 10%, that it was a significant improvement. The whole thing is ludicrous. And to write something like that almost implies that the people who wrote it think that what they're doing is okay. And time again, we've been asking about it. And time again, we've received non-answers. So my question is, if the people who are supposed to be doing these appraisals don't want to do them, why don't they come here and tell us why they don't want to do them? We've asked them enough times to tell us why they don't want to do them. And lagging in time of how they recorded, which had happened previously. So what appeared to be 29% wasn't when we got the answer from Chris Hines. So how much of this is actually true? How many people actually have an appraisal for that year?
Thank you, Chair. As I explained to the previous committee, I accept all the comments and concerns from members, including from a HR point of view. I'm here kind of because we pull together the figures and also try and drive what we can for our centre to improve performance. As I said at the previous meeting, I fully understand concerns and fully accept that this is an area the council needs to improve. I do have the latest figures, but I'm not coming here to say that I think that it's acceptable because of, again, my understanding concerns. The work we've done to try and follow up on non-compliance is with procedure directors and chief officers. They have details of those matters that are not completed appraisals, and they're working through the reasons why those are. And as ever, there'll be some reasons why that is the case, that are valid and some that are just a basic concern. And that's currently with each department head to work through. The updated figures show that around about 84% of matters are done, and somewhere in the region of 65-66% of employee appraisals are done. We've got some significant areas in our more remote workers where there's some concerns about the performance levels. So areas where it's not traditional managers sitting with a team type scenario where we've got perhaps ranger service or cleaners or caterers where most of our problems lie in terms of getting the numbers completed. We've got a couple of issues with data which have just impacted on the numbers slightly but would improve them. Where we've got multiple job holders who have an appraisal but not in both jobs, where we've deemed unnecessary to have to, but it's just not been reported that way. But overall, I understand and accept the committee's concerns, and there has been gone back to chief officers to follow up in their individual service areas and take what action they consider to be necessary.
Like I say, I mean, thanks for speaking to the committee. I'm sure everyone here is aware that it's not just HR responsible, this is a corporate target. So we do thank you for coming and facing the fire and I was aware. Phil, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Chair. On page 27, regarding sickness absence, I understand that Councillor Patrick asked for a breakdown in departments where the police departments are suffering those sicknesses. Did that stay down?
I would have thought it would have double checked, but I would expect it to have been passed back and to be on the convention.
Okay, and next, on page 31, report 23, the average number of days after the process changed in circumstances better for the claimants. This is an oasis change of address, this could be someone terminating their benefit received, and that can actually impact quite heavily upon households who've got a low income when they need to rightly give that money back if it's already been spent. I just wonder, I'm not really sure what there being a backlog due to age of claims. I'm not sure what that means. And do you expect a backlog this year as well? If so, is anything in place to kind of compete with that backlog to make sure we give him far less? Says due to the age of claims. I presume you mean a lot of the claims are quite old and you had to deal with that backlog.
Yeah, so basically, just give a little bit of quantity to how much we've actually improved. In April 2015, we had some 19,000 transactions outstanding on on housing benefit to be processed. Currently, we're at a total of 4,000. So over the year, we've made significant progress, and the direction of travel is certainly showing an improvement. The backlogs that we referred to, I think those backlogs did occur for a number of reasons, and that was around the whole change in the operating model for the benefits service and the numbers that we had to deliver. There was also a loss of skill, etc. So we're not making that an excuse for the backlog, because the backlog has been there, but what I will say is where we are currently today is a better position than we've been for some 8 months now. We are reducing the days by which it takes us to process the changes. We are backfilling our vacancies, we are upskilling our staff, and there are a number of reviews underway at the moment. We're working really closely with the DWP and their performance development teams to look at how we're actually processing. The age profiles have come down significantly, and if it's required, I can certainly share some details around that and volumes around the age profile. If we go back to earlier in the year, and we split our age profiles up into months, there was higher volumes in older age profile brackets. We've actually turned that around now, so that it's the way we're working is our current work that's coming in is being cleared as we're delivering, so we don't see no new backlogs developing, and we certainly are making inroads into those backlogs significantly in the age profile. As a result of that, we can't change the date that we receive those claims on those changes. So that is having an impact on a number of other areas, but we have to go through that pain to get to a more positive place, if that makes sense.
So, sorry, Ted, you're confident that you're in a better place and more robust to make sure it's not going to be another backlog?
I am confidence, and I think we're doing a hell of a lot in the transaction centre, particularly since I've joined around reviewing how we work, identifying where our inefficiencies are, and it's a much bigger project than just looking at one silo area. It's looking at how our key stakeholders, our residents and our benefits applicants, actually deliver the information that we need to process those changes. So there's a lot more to it than just actually receiving a change and considering what needs to be done. It's actually how proactive we can be to support the residents and the information that they give to our frontline staff, and how we can work with our IT departments and our existing benefit processes to further make those efficient. And we are doing a hell of a lot of work at the moment in those areas, both across council tax and other benefits.
Actually,
so we've got a
person, we've got Neil. Well, just as if, this says here that average number of days are accurately processed, and you not accurately processed?
I can certainly come back with those kinds of
figures,
but I don't
have that. Because that must have a real run-on in time, cost, and effort.
It certainly does. I think the words accurately, possibly consider how we actually use that, because it's accurately processed. Are we actually saying, hey, and I would be to my team managers, is it claims accurately submitted?
Yeah.
Not necessarily accurately processed, because our local authority level of error based around actual entering the wrong information onto the system and coming up with the wrong notification letter, I'm quite confident to say that's minimal. When we look at a local authority error, a claim actually becomes a local authority error when it's waited too long to be processed. Because as Tom's mentioned previously, there's a sort of process that a claim goes through. It's tenant error, it's local authority error, it's technical error. So in answer to your question, I think the reports that we get back from DWP do certainly highlight that the error rate from actual mis-entry into the system is relatively low. It's more around efficiency than accuracy. What we're doing with the front end is that make sure we get all that information to process back end and to reduce that overall time.
The other bit of my question is that I don't want to worry just to consider about management stuff. I still can't get my head around why the management
we haven't had these reviews of staff, because is the, what happens when a manager doesn't do the job he's supposed to do within the council?
I'm talking about when in business, if you have to do appraisals of your staff, and on a certain day you have to get a good bar,
is it different with the council where they can choose whether they do them or not, or whether they can fire them or not? Because I've never come across that.
I think all of the committee shares that concern about this, which is why we all agreed that this would be passed to Adrian Jones, and also we request the presence of Cllr Rob here to maybe talk through the next committee, because we do tend to go over the same item every single time. Well, hopefully, we might get
some. Adrian is going to be appraisal, he's going to get about appraisal.
If he gets one, if he gets it all, yeah.
Thanks, Chair. I was actually going to say something along the same line as Chris, so I won't re-ask the question. But one thing I'd like to know is, and I did ask it last time, is why the target is only 80%? Because we're not all being people here. Adrian, Andrew. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Lisa.
Item number 7, financial monitoring report to Tom, back to you again.
This is the event again, it's the regular report, which is the second quarter update on the financial performance. I'll draw your attention to the position of the section 4 down on the table. The attention for this director is the money spent of £3 million by the year end. Although the claiming credit for that, the large chunk of that is down to trading managers on £500,000 due to staffing change and other areas. The main one is trading managers explained in shooting paragraphs down there. But it is the way that the council seeks to work internally borrowing rather than externally borrowing, which reduces our borrowing costs. We're looking to use our investments wherever we can to minimise our cost of borrowing. We're looking to get money we can do there. It's affected by the capital programme. So the capital programme slips. There's a slippage in the year whether we need to borrow or not. And so the population of all those factors put together. The projection is we're looking to spend around about £2.5 million on trade management activities. So it's perhaps taking money is perhaps it's an add-on to Cllr to give them scope. It's not really a service as such. It is, again, that's what we're getting to us, it's affected by other issues outside this time.
Thanks, Tom.
Adam?
Just on the 4.4, Tom, does that include that currently when we move into other councils and we have a similar 4.5%, does that mean we call back those before we borrow the 3.5%?
It's really investment. What we do is invest any surplus cash we've got through our office to be test rated according to the Australian management policy. As that stands, we've got various investments with various banks, building societies, and there's quite a number of external local authorities. What we go with is the investment is the best place to return whilst giving security about that investment. So wherever we can, we do see through that surplus cash, which tends to be short term rather than long term.
I think it's worth saying there will be, before certainly the other committees where the budget isn't in such a healthy position. Given what we all know with the comprehensive spending review and the further impact on the council, any underspend in any department will be very valuable in setting the budget for the year. So I think, credit where credit's due. We would be criticised when it was an overspend, would you not? So let's give credit where there's an understands report which will help save many saves.
Absolutely agree with you, thanks for that. So are we at one more?
Chair, can I just come back on that? Given, I do appreciate it was an underspend, but given that some of it was due to the treasury management and there's still a lot of concerns over some of the savings that we've delivered, it may be like in balancing out rather than those areas where we have put savings in that haven't been made. So we do need to keep that in mind.
If we just come back on the areas of concern then, the inclusive implementation plan for savings could be delivered. What is up to 120,000 adding funds to be delivered? The other issue relates to line, which you can cover by reserve, but it's really just a slip between delivery of savings, should be the savings this year. So they're always asking for the full part of it.
Okay, well, we have to read recommendation and report.
That's it.
Our last item on the agenda is the student work programme. Not a great deal on this tonight, really. You have read the very small report. Just a small update on, Adam, would you like to give us a small update on, because you're chairing the task and finish on the disaster recovery strategy?
Yeah, there's not much to report about. We've had our initial scoping meeting and identify evidence that we want to grab in the next of the session shortly in the new year to gather the evidence and the recommendations after that. But we've only had the initial scoping meeting. I've got 10 out of 10 as a press by Bolton to the program that we send for the next day.
Well, I just had on a recommendation that we have the FOI test and finish as well. That's our work programme.
Yeah,
yes. Well, I'm not aware of any other business, so I'd like to thank you all for your time tonight and your participation. Thank you.